Or Cheryl. Do you want to start, Meg?
I don't mind, Cheryl.
Yeah, we can start.
Go for it.
Want me to start with chapter one, introduction?
Yep.
The Man Who Thought, his way into partnership with Thomas A. Edison. Truly, thoughts are things, and powerful things at that, when they are mixed with definiteness of purpose, persistence, and a burning desire for their translation into riches or other material objects. A little more than 30 years ago, Edwin C. Barnes discovered how true it is that men really do think and grow rich. His discovery did not come about at one sitting. It came little by little, beginning with a burning desire to become a business associate of the great Edison. One of the chief characteristics of Barnes' desire was that it was definite. He wanted to work with Edison, not for him. Observe carefully the description of how he went about translating his desire into reality, and you will have a better understanding of the 13 principles which lead to riches. When this desire or impulse of thought first flashed into his mind, he was in no position to act upon it. Two difficulties stood in his way. He did not know Mr. Edison, and he did not have enough money to pay his railroad fare to Orange, New Jersey. These difficulties were sufficient to have discouraged the majority of men from making any attempt to carry out the desire. But his was no ordinary desire. He was so determined to find a way to carry out his desire that he finally decided to travel by blind baggage rather than be defeated. To the uninitiated, this means that he went to East Orange on a freight train. He presented himself at Mr. Edison's laboratory and announced he had come to go into business with the inventor. In speaking of the first meeting between Barnes and Edison years later, Mr. Edison said, "He stood there before me, looking like an ordinary tramp, but there was something in the expression of his face which conveyed the impression that he was determined to get what he had come after. I had learned from years of experience with men that when a man really desires a thing so deeply that he is willing to stake his entire future on a single turn of the wheel in order to get it, he is sure to win. I gave him the opportunity he asked for because I saw he had made up his mind to stand by until he succeeded. Subsequent events proved that no mistake was made." Just what young Barnes said to Mr. Edison on that occasion was far less important than that which he thought. Edison himself said so. It could not have been the young man's appearance which got him his start in the Edison office, for that was definitely against him. It was what he thought that counted. If the significance of this statement could be conveyed to either person, to every person who reads it, there would be no need for the remainder of this book. Barnes did not get his partnership with Edison on his first interview. He did get a chance to work in the Edison offices at a very nominal wage, doing work that was unimportant to Edison, but most important to Barnes, because it gave him an opportunity to display his merchandise where his intended partner could see it. Months went by. Apparently nothing happened to bring the coveted goal which Barnes had set up in his mind as his definite major purpose. But something important was happening in Barnes' mind. He was constantly intensifying his desire to become the business associate of Edison. Psychologists have correctly said that when one is truly ready for a thing, it puts in its appearance. Barnes was ready for a business association with Edison. Moreover, he was determined to remain ready until he got that which he was seeking. He did not say to himself, "Ah, well, what's the use? I guess I'll change my mind and try for a salesman's job." But he did say, "I came here to go into business with Edison, and I'll accomplish this end if it takes the remainder of my life." He meant it. What a different story men would have to tell if only they would adopt a definite purpose and stand by that purpose until it had time to become an all-consuming obsession. Maybe young Barnes did not know it at the time, but his bulldog determination, his persistence in standing back of a single desire, was destined to mow down all opposition and bring him the opportunity he was seeking. When the opportunity came, it appeared in a different form and from a different direction than Barnes had expected. That is one of the tricks of opportunity. It has a sly habit of slipping in by the back door, and often it comes disguised in the form of misfortune or temporary defeat. Perhaps this is why so many fail to recognize opportunity. Mr. Edison had just perfected a new office device known at the time as the Edison Dictating Machine, now the Ediphone. His salesmen were not enthusiastic over the machine. They did not believe it could be sold without great effort. Barnes saw his opportunity. It had crawled in quietly, hidden in a queer-looking machine, which interested no one but Barnes and the inventor. Barnes knew he could sell the Edison Dictating Machine. He suggested this to Edison and promptly got his chance. He did sell the machine. In fact, he sold it so successfully that Edison gave him a contract to distribute and market it all over the nation. Out of that business association grew the slogan, made by Edison and installed by Barnes. The business alliance has been in operation for more than 30 years. Out of it, Barnes has made himself rich in money, but he has done something infinitely greater. He has proved that one really may think and grow rich. How much actual cash that original desire of Barnes has been worth to him, I have no way of knowing. Perhaps it has brought him $2 or $3 million, but the amount, whatever it is, becomes insignificant when compared with the greater asset he acquired in the form of definite knowledge that an intangible impulse of thought can be transmuted into its physical counterpart by the application of known principles. Barnes literally thought himself into a partnership with the great Edison. He thought himself into a fortune. He had nothing to start with except the capacity to know what he wanted and the determination to stand by that desire until he realized it. He had no money to begin with. He had but little education. He had no influence, but he did have initiative, faith, and the will to win. With these intangible forces, he made himself number one man with the greatest inventor who ever lived. Now let us look at a different situation and study a man who had plenty of tangible evidences of riches, but lost it because he stopped 3 feet short of the goal he was seeking. Somebody else want to turn now?
I'll go if you like. 3 feet from gold. One of the most common causes of failure is the habit of quitting when one is overtaken by temporary defeat. Every person is guilty of this mistake at one time or another. An uncle of R.U. Darby was caught by the gold fever in the gold rush days and went west to dig and grow rich. He had never heard that more gold was being mined in the brains of men than has ever been taken from the earth. He staked a claim and went to work with his pick and shovel. The going was hard, but his lust for gold was definite. After weeks of labour, he was rewarded by the discovery of the shining ore. He needed machinery to bring the ore to the surface. Quietly, he covered up the mine, retraced his footsteps to his home in Williamsburg, Maryland, told his relatives and a few neighbours of his strike. They got together money for the needed machinery, had it shipped. The uncle and Darby went back to work the mine. The first car of ore was mined and shipped to a smelter. The returns proved that they had one of the richest mines in Colorado. A few more cars of that ore would clear the debts. Then would come the big killing in profits. Down went the drills, up went the hopes of Darby and Uncle. Then something happened. The vein of ore disappeared. They'd come to the end of the rainbow and the pot of gold was no longer there. They drilled on, desperately trying to pick up the vein again. All to no avail. Finally, they decided to quit. They sold the machinery to a junk man for a few hundred dollars and took the train back home. Some junk men are dumb, but not this one. He called in a mining engineer to look at the mine and do a little calculating. The engineer advised that the project had failed because the two owners were not familiar with fault lines. His calculations showed that the vein would be found just 3 feet from where the Darbys had stopped drilling. That is exactly where it was found. The junk man took millions of dollars of ore from the mine because he knew enough to seek expert counsel before giving up. Most of the money which went into the machinery was procured through the efforts of R.U. Darby, who was then a very young man. The money came from his relatives and neighbours because of their faith in him. He paid back every dollar of it, although he was years in doing so. Long afterward, Mr. Darby recouped his loss many times over when he made the discovery that desire can be transmuted into gold. The discovery came after he went into the business of selling life insurance. Remembering that he lost a huge fortune because he stopped 3 feet from gold, Darby profited by the experience of his chosen work by the simple method of saying to himself, "I stopped 3 feet from gold, but I will never stop because men say no when I ask them to buy insurance." Darby is one of a small group of... Christos, do you want to take over for a bit? I'm going to frog. Thank you.
Swallow. You've got to swallow it. You've got to swallow it. Okay. Darby is one of a small group of fewer than 50 men who sell more than $1 million in life insurance annually. He owes his stickability to the lesson he learned from his quitability in the gold mining business. Before success comes in any man's life or woman's life, he is sure to meet with much temporary defeat and perhaps some failure. When defeat overtakes person, the easiest and most logical thing to do is to quit. That is exactly what the majority of people do. More than 500 of the most successful people this country has ever known told the author that greatest success came just one step beyond the point at which defeat had overtaken them. Failure is a trickster with a keen sense of irony and cunning. It takes great delight in tripping one when success is almost within reach. A 50-cent lesson in persistence. Shortly after Mr. Darby received his degree from the University of Hard Knocks and had decided to profit by his experience in the gold mining business, he had the good fortune to be present on an occasion that proved to him that no does not necessarily mean no. One afternoon, he was helping his uncle grind wheat in an old-fashioned mill. The uncle operated a large farm on which a number of colored sharecrop farmers lived. Quietly, the door was opened and a small colored child, the daughter of a tenant, walked in and took her place near the door. The uncle looked up, saw the child, and barked at her roughly, "What do you want?" Meekly, the child replied, "My mommy says send her 50 cents." "I will not do it," the uncle retorted. "Now you run on home." "Yes, sir," the child replied, but she did not move. The uncle went ahead with his work, so busily engaged that he did not pay enough attention to the child to observe that she did not leave. When he looked up and saw her still standing there, he yelled at her, "I told you to go on home. Now go or I'll take a switch to you." The little girl said, "Yes, sir," but she did not budge an inch. The uncle dropped a sack of grain he was about to pour into the mill hopper, picked up a barrel stave, and started toward the child with an expression on his face that indicated trouble. Darby held his breath. He was certain he was about to witness a murder. He knew his uncle had a fierce temper. He knew that colored children were not supposed to defy white people in that part of the country. When the uncle reached the spot where the child was standing, she quickly stepped forward one step, looked up into his eyes and screamed at the top of her shrill voice, "My mommy's got to have that 50 cents. The uncle stopped, looked at her for a minute, then slowly laid the barrel stave on the floor, put his hand in his pocket, took out half a dollar and gave it to her. The child took the money and slowly backed toward the door, never taking her eyes off the man whom she had just conquered. After she had gone, the uncle sat down on a box and looked out the window into space for more than 10 minutes. He was pondering with awe over the whipping he had just taken. Mr. Darby, too, was doing some thinking. That was the first time in all his experience that he had seen a colored child deliberately master an adult white person. How did she do it? What happened to his uncle that caused him to lose his fierceness and become as docile as a lamb? What strange power did this child use that made her master over her superior? These and other similar questions flashed into Darby's mind, but he did not find the answer until years later when he told me the story. Strangely, the story of this unusual experience was told to the author in the old mill on the very spot where the uncle took his whipping. Strangely, too, I had devoted nearly a quarter of a century to the study of the power which enabled an ignorant, illiterate, colored child to conquer an intelligent man. As we stood there in that musty old mill, Mr. Darby repeated the story of the unusual conquest and finished by asking, "What can you make of it? What strange power did that child use that so completely whipped my uncle?" The answer to his question will be found in the principles described in this book. The answer is full and complete. It contains details and instructions sufficient to enable anyone to understand and apply the same force which the little child accidentally stumbled upon. Keep your mind alert, and you will observe exactly what strange power came to the rescue of the child. You will catch a glimpse of this power in the next chapter. Somewhere in the book, you will find an idea that will quicken your receptive powers and place at your command, for your own benefit, this same irresistible power. The awareness of this power may come to you in the first chapter, or it may flash into your mind in some subsequent chapter. It may come in the form of a single idea, or it may come in the nature of a plan or a purpose. Again, it may cause you to go back into your past experiences of failure or defeat and bring to the surface some lesson by which you can regain all that you lost through defeat. After I had described to Mr. Darby the power unwittingly used by the little colored child, he quickly retraced his 30 years of experience as a life insurance salesman and frankly acknowledged that his success in that field was due, in no small degree, to the lesson he had learned from their child. Mr. Darby pointed out, "Every time a prospect tried to bow me out without buying, I saw that child standing there in the old mill, her big eyes glaring in defiance, and I said to myself, I've got to make this sale. The better portion of all sales I have made were made after people had said no." He recalled, too, his mistake in having stopped only 3 feet from gold. "But," he said, "that experience was a blessing in disguise. It taught me to keep on keeping on, no matter how hard the going may be, a lesson I need to learn before I could succeed in anything." This story of Mr. Darby and his uncle, the colored child and the gold mine, doubtless will be read by hundreds of men who make their living by selling life insurance. And to all of these, the author wishes to offer the suggestion that Darby owes to these two experiences his ability to sell more than $1 million of life insurance every year. Cheryl? Cheryl?
Hang on, I forgot I muted myself. Yeah, the neighbors were upstairs pounding around, and so I thought, oh, I better mute myself. Okay, I'll take over. Life is strange and often imponderable. Both the successes and the failures have their roots in simple experiences. Mr. Darby's experiences were commonplace and simple enough, yet they held the answer to his destiny in life. Therefore, they were as important to him as life itself. He profited by these two dramatic experiences because he analyzed them and found the lesson they taught. But what of the man who has neither the time nor the inclination to study failure in search of knowledge that may lead to success? Where and how is he to learn the art of converting defeat into stepping stones to opportunity? In answers to these questions, this book was written. The answer called for a description of 13 principles. But remember, as you read, the answer you may be seeking to the questions which may have caused you to ponder over the strangeness of life may be found in your own mind through some idea, plan, or purpose which may spring into your mind as you read. One sound idea is all that one needs to achieve success. The principles described in this book contain the best and the most practical of all that is known concerning ways and means of creating useful ideas. Before we go any further in our approach to the description of these principles, we believe you are entitled to receive this important suggestion. When riches begin to come, they come so quickly in such great abundance that one wonders where they have been hiding during all those lean years. This is an astounding statement, and all the more so when we take into consideration the popular belief that riches come only to those who work hard and long. When you begin to think and grow rich, you will observe that riches begin with a state of mind, with definiteness of purpose, with little or no hard work. You and every other person ought to be interested in knowing how to acquire that state of mind which will attract riches. I spent 25 years in research, analyzing more than 25,000 people because I, too, wanted to know how wealthy men become that way. Without that research, this book could not have been written. Here, take notice of a very significant truth, viz. The business depression started in 1929 and continued on to an all-time record of destruction until sometime after President Roosevelt entered office. Then the depression began to fade into nothingness, just as an electrician in a theater raises the light so gradually that darkness is transmuted into light before you realize it, so did the spell of fear in the minds of the people gradually fade away and become faith. Observe very closely. As soon as you master the principles of this philosophy and begin to follow the instructions for applying those principles, your financial status will begin to improve and everything you touch will begin to transmute itself into an asset for your benefit. Impossible? Not at all. One of the main weaknesses of mankind is the average man's familiarity with the word impossible. He knows all the rules which will not work. He knows all the things that which cannot be done. This book was written for those who seek the rules which have made others successful and are willing to stake everything on those rules. A great many years ago, I purchased a fine dictionary. The first thing I did with it was to turn to the word impossible and neatly clip it out of the book. That would not be an unwise thing for you to do. Success comes to those who become success conscious. Failure comes to those who indifferently allow themselves to become failure conscious. The object of this book is to help all who seek it to learn the art of changing their minds from failure consciousness to success consciousness. Another weakness found in altogether too many people is the habit of measuring everything and everyone by their own impressions and beliefs. Some who will read this will believe that no one can think and grow rich. They cannot think in terms of riches, because their thought habits have been steeped in poverty, want, misery, failure, and defeat. These unfortunate people remind me of a prominent Chinese who came to America to be educated in American ways. He attended the University of Chicago. One day, President Harper met this young Oriental on the campus, stopped to chat with him for a few minutes, and asked what had impressed him as being the most noticeable characteristic of the American people. "Why," the Chinaman exclaimed, the queer slant of your eyes. Your eyes are off slant. What do we say about the Chinese? We refuse to believe that which we do not understand. We foolishly believe that our own limitations are the proper measure of limitations. Sure, the other fellow's eyes are off slant because they are not the same as our own. Millions of people look at the achievements of Henry Ford after he has arrived and envy him because of his good fortune or luck or genius or whatever it is that they credit for Ford's fortune. Perhaps one person in every 100,000 knows the secret of Ford's success, and those who do know are too modest or too reluctant to speak of it because of its simplicity. A single transaction will illustrate this secret perfectly. A few years back, Ford decided to produce his now famous V8 motor. He chose to build an engine with the entire 8 cylinders cast in one block and instructed his engineers to produce a design for the engine. The design was placed on paper, but the engineers agreed to a man that it was simply impossible to cast an 8-cylinder gas engine block in one piece. Ford said, produce it anyways. But they replied, it's impossible. Go ahead, Ford command, and stay on the job until you succeed, no matter how much time is required. The engineers went ahead. There was nothing else for them to do if they were to remain on the Ford staff. 6 months went by. Nothing happened. Another 6 months passed, and still nothing happened. The engineer tried every conceivable plan to carry out the orders, but the thing seemed out of the question. Impossible. At the end of the year, Ford checked with his engineers, and again, they informed him they had found no way to carry out his orders. Go right ahead, said Ford. I want it, and I'll have it. They went ahead, and then, as if by a stroke of magic, the secret was discovered. The Ford determination had won once more. This story may not be described with minute accuracy, but the sum and substance of it is correct. Deduce from it, you who wish to think and grow rich, the secret of the Ford Millions if you can. You'll not have to look very far. Henry Ford is success because he understands and applies the principles of success. One of these is desire, knowing what one wants. Remember this Ford story as you read and pick out the lines in which the secret of his stupendous achievement have been described. If you can do this, if you can lay your finger on the particular group of principles which made Henry Ford rich, you can equal his achievements in almost any calling for which you are suited. Nicole, are you okay to read for a bit?
Yeah, I'll go again.
Okay.
Oh, hi, Lorraine. Thank you. Welcome.
Hi, if it's too distracted with the noise, just let me know, all right?
Okay.
1 moment.
Okay.
You are the master of your fate, the captain of your soul, because when Henley wrote the prophetic lines, I am the master of my fate, I am the captain of my soul, he should have informed us that we are the masters of our fate, the captains of our soul, because we have the power to control our thoughts. He should have told us that the ether in which this little earth floats, in which we move and have our being, is a form of energy moving at an inconceivably high rate of vibration, and that the ether is filled with a form of universal power which adapts itself to the nature of the thoughts we hold in our minds and influences us in natural ways to transmute our thoughts into their physical equivalent. If the poet had told us of this great truth, we would know why it is that we are the masters of our fate, the captains of our souls. He should have told us with great emphasis that this power makes no attempt to discriminate between destructive thoughts and constructive thoughts, that it will urge us to translate into physical reality thoughts of poverty just as quickly as it will influence us to act upon thoughts of riches. He should have told us, too, that our brains become magnetized with the dominating thoughts which we hold in our minds, and, by means with which no man is familiar, these magnets attract to us the forces, the people, the circumstances of life, which harmonize with the nature of our dominating thoughts. He should have told us that before we can accumulate riches in great abundance, we must magnetize our minds with intense desire for riches, that we must become money conscious until the desire for money drives us to create definite plans for acquiring it. But being a poet and not a philosopher, Henley contented himself by stating a great truth in poetic form, leaving those who followed him to interpret the philosophical meanings of his lines. Little by little, the truth has unfolded itself until it now appears certain that the principles described in this book hold the secret of mastery over our economic fate. We are now ready to examine the first of these principles. Maintain a spirit of open-mindedness and remember as you read, they are the invention of no one man. The principles were gathered from the life experiences of more than 500 men who actually accumulated riches in huge amounts. Men who began in poverty, but with little education, without influence. The principles worked for these men. You can put them to work for your own enduring benefit. you will find it easy, not hard to do. Before you read the next chapter, I want you to know that it conveys factual information which might easily change your entire financial destiny, as it has so definitely brought changes of stupendous proportions to two people described. I want you to know also that the relationship between these two men and myself is such that I could have taken no liberties with the facts, even if I had wished to do so. One of them has been my closest personal friend for almost 25 years. The other is my own son. The unusual success of these two men described in the next chapter more than justifies this personal reference as a means of emphasizing the far-flung power of this principle. Almost 15 years ago, I discovered the commencement address at, delivered the commencement address at Salem College, Salem, West Virginia. I emphasized the principle described in the next chapter with so much intensity that one of the members of the graduating class definitely appropriated it and made it a part of his own philosophy. The young man is now a member of Congress and an important factor in the present administration. Just before this book went to the publisher, he wrote me a letter in which he so clearly stated his opinion of the principle outlined in the next chapter that I have chosen to publish his letter as an introduction to that chapter. It gives you an idea of the rewards to come. My dear Napoleon, my service as a member of Congress having given me an insight into the problems of men and women, I am writing to offer a suggestion which may become helpful to thousands of worthy people. With apologies, I must state that the suggestion, if acted upon, will mean several years of labor and responsibility for you, but I am enheartened to make the suggestion because I know your great love for rendering useful service. In 1922, you delivered the commencement address at Salem College when I was a member of the graduating class. In that address, you planted in my mind an idea which has been responsible for the opportunity I now have to serve the people of my state and will be responsible in a very large measure for whatever success I may have in the future. The suggestion I have in mind is that you put into a book the sum and substance of the address you delivered at Salem College and in that way give the people of America an opportunity to profit by your many years of experience and association with the men who, by their greatness, have made America the richest nation on the earth. I recall as though it were yesterday the marvelous description you gave of the method by which Henry Ford, with but little schooling, without a dollar, with no influential friends, rose to great heights. I made up my mind then, even before you had finished your speech, that I would make a place for myself, no matter how many difficulties I had to surmount. Thousands of young people will finish their schooling this year, and within the next few years, every one of them will be seeking just such a message of practical encouragement as the one I received from you. They will want to know where to turn, what to do to get started in life. You can tell them, because you have helped to solve the problems of so many, many people. If there is any possible way that you can afford to render so great a service, may I offer the suggestion that you include with every book one of your personal analysis charts, in order that the purchaser of the book may have the benefit of a complete self-inventory, indicating, as you indicated to me years ago, exactly what is standing in the way of success. Such a service as this, providing the readers of your book with a complete, unbiased picture of their faults and their virtues, would mean to them the difference between success and failure. The service would be priceless. Millions of people are now facing the problem of staging a comeback because of the depression, and I speak from personal experience when I say, I know these earnest people would welcome the opportunity to tell you their problems and to receive your suggestions for the solution. You know the problems of those who face the necessity of beginning all over again. There are thousands of people in America today who would like to know how they can convert ideas into money, people who must start at scratch without finances and recoup their losses. If anyone can help them, you can. If you publish the book, I would like to own the first copy that comes from the press, personally autographed by you. With best wishes, believe me, cordially yours, Jennings Randolph.
Lovely. Let's go back to the start and discuss. he gets straight into how Barnes is becoming came little by little, and that really makes us feel better, because a lot of us have been trying really hard to get ourselves moving forward with what we really want and how to make it happen, and just knowing that it comes little by little, even to someone who had the most extraordinary success, is good to know.
Yeah, it really is. And he actually calls that, labels it as a success, kind of, that it was growing. Like he was doing something that was not nearly what he was wanting to do, but still he was being successful while he was doing that, because it was growing his desire.
Yeah, and he says here that it was no ordinary desire. He was determined, so he knew within himself that it was going to happen, and he didn't see any of the positions that he was given in the meantime as failure, even though many people probably would. He knew that each one was a stepping stone towards where he knew he was going to end up.
Yeah, that was quite good for me, actually, because I have had this question of time. Been mulling that over for ages. It's just been there. How long things take, and if there's any way I can influence that. And actually, I've read this. I think, did it say 5 years? No, I'm reading something. Did it take 5 years?
I'm not sure, actually.
I don't know if it says it here or I've read it somewhere else.
No, it says months went by.
Okay. All right, months. I'm sure I read something that it took. I read that it took about a year.
Lorraine, that seems familiar from somewhere.
Yeah. And it's funny because that dawned on me today that actually I've been looking at this all wrong. I've actually been looking at this in quite an impatient manner, although I wasn't realizing that I was. I read this last week and it didn't dawn on me. I was thinking, God, how long? I've still been thinking how to make things quicker. And that's obviously not a very good thing to do. Just the way that I'm sure it's fine to be curious about time. But actually it means that I'm not being completely in faith with my circumstances as they are. You know, because there are things that are happening and I'm being grateful and then quickly moving on. And that's not a good idea. That makes sense.
Yeah.
I'm trying to rush.
Yeah.
And I am thinking, grateful, but I'm trying to rush. Yeah.
Yeah. Thinking this isn't happening fast enough creates it not happening fast enough.
Yeah. Exactly. And I was aware of that, but it just, you know, obviously snapped into place today. I must have been reading or cross-referencing something else where I got the 5 years, and I was thinking, well, hang on a minute, actually things are happening and I'm not really appreciating if I'm in that mode of come on, I'm not actually really appreciating how I'm growing and what I'm getting and things that are, you know, that I have got to be grateful for. So that was a little learning for me.
Yeah, and that's a good example of the little by little too, because you come across a piece of information that adds to another piece of information that gives you a realization that, okay, I'm on the right track and keep moving forward. It's like a big jigsaw puzzle.
See, that little thing, and it's something that Cheryl actually said, you know, the bit about success, it reminds me about Earl's saying, success is a progressive realization of a worthy ideal. So it doesn't really matter what we do, as long as we're moving forward towards our definite purpose, we're going to reach it as long as we're constantly working towards it. The thing with time is not something that we can control, because I used to even think that if you put more action into it, then you'll bring it closer to you. And recently I've realized that's not necessarily the case. It's just a continuous action. You've got faith in your definite purpose actually coming to reality, coming to physical reality. And it's just that constant movement. It's when you stop moving that you move further away from it. So just by continually doing something, Lorraine, you're just getting yourself closer and closer to it. And it doesn't matter how much we do, it will come in its own time.
Something that I read this week again, Lorraine, I've read it like hundreds of times, but it really hit home to me this week, was that things will show up when I'm ready for them, and I'm going, okay, I guess that means I'm not ready. I still got more growing to do. I've got more faith to cultivate. So I'm not ready yet. So I'm okay with it. I'm just going to keep working, and it's going to show up when I'm ready. And that makes me feel a little bit more confident, because it's a little scary to me to think that. I still was a little bit scary about the goals that I have, and I'm going, oh wow, like these are big audacious goals. They're scaring me. So, you know, maybe when I get closer to being ready, it won't be so scary.
And isn't the most exciting and fun part the getting ready, the growing and the achieving the little bits as you go along and seeing the change in yourself?
Yeah, it should be.
Yeah, I think so. I definitely, it's just been an incredible experience so far, and continues to be. It really does. And things show up, and I'm like, that's not how I asked for it. You know, like, so I have to go back and alter it and get a little bit more definite, but it's fun. It's fun. For sure.
And it's really a state of mind too, like how he's talking here about years later, when Mr. Edison said that when he stood there before me, he looked like an ordinary tramp, but there was something in the expression of his face that conveyed that he was determined to get what he wanted. And then further on, it says that he'd made up his mind to stand until he was successful. So he would have picked up on the energy from Barnes during that meeting, and that's why he gave him a chance. If it had been just the way he looked, he wouldn't have stood a chance. But there was something within him, a decision that he'd made. He knew that he was going to accomplish what he had decided to come and do, and that was conveyed through his thoughts, and that's what was picked up on by Edison. That's what got him in his state of mind.
And Lorraine, you just, when you mentioned that, you know, things are happening and you're saying, well, that's not how I asked for it. Right here in line 83 and 84, it says, when the opportunity came, it appeared in a different form and from a different direction than Barnes had expected. So, So the clue, I guess, is to just to be aware, like maybe things are happening more than you realized if you're looking for them only in one form, right?
It's not, you know, sometimes we get things that we don't really want, but we don't get what we really want. I'll give you two really good examples. About a year ago, I was offered a job to do basically be a security supervisor in a really good private hospital here, which deals with the British Army as well. So theoretically speaking, I was actually a perfect candidate, because I'm ex-military, ex-British Army. I can go in there and I can be a security supervisor. Awesome. Didn't get the job. Now, initially I thought to myself, yeah, but that would have been good. And then I suddenly realized, but I didn't really want it. So in a sense, I didn't get that. But what I did get was two guys who said to me, look, do you mind coming over and doing a couple of jobs every now and then for us? And I said, no, that's fine. So for about 9 months, I was doing that. And it gave me the opportunity to sort of step back and say to myself, you know, sometimes what we want, we don't get it. And there's a reason behind it. It's because we really don't want to get it. And we're not sending out that our feelings are not completely behind that purpose. So even though I was thinking that would be a good job to have, I really didn't want it. And my feelings weren't attached to it. Whereas I wanted a little bit more free time for myself so I could study more. And that's what I got. Now, when I suddenly thought to myself, right, I need a little bit more money, but I want it part-time. This was on a Thursday night, and it was about 8 o'clock at night. And then 10 o'clock the following morning, I get a phone call from a guy where I'm working now, and he says to me, do you mind coming in, working part-time whilst, you know, the hotel is closed, they're doing renovations, and you get paid this much? So I went over and I said to him, well, I want to get paid this much, and he said, fine. So on the first part, if you can imagine, it's like my feelings weren't put behind it. Whereas on the second part, the transmutation of that purpose to a physical reality happened within 24 hours. And that is something that you can't not express. It's just that the thought that it does happen. So when you get something which comes from the left or the right and you're not expecting it, sometimes it leads you to, it could be just meeting that one person who can help you towards your dream. And it could be the other way around as well. It doesn't have to be about them helping you with your dream. It could be you helping them with their dream. So that opportunity that comes sideways, that it just appears, is not always just about you. It could be about helping somebody else. And I think it's like Nicole said, you know, it's a journey. And we've got to enjoy this journey because it's life. And it's something that even today I realized on myself, like you were saying about time. And it's something that suddenly clicked to me as well, even though it's something I know. I was sitting there, I thought to myself, you know, I'm doing this, I want to move away from this job, do this. And then I suddenly thought to myself, you know, I've still got a few lessons to learn. And, you know, these lessons that I'm still learning that I've been going through for the past 2 weeks, it's something that I'm still learning. I thought to myself, yeah, maybe I need to stay here just a little bit longer, but not too long, because I need to be getting on with what I need to be getting on. So sometimes, Lorraine, we don't always get what we want, and we do get, you know, that, what you may call it, that side bit. But there's a purpose behind it.
Get the lesson that you need.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was listening to somebody today talk about that sometimes you get something that you really don't want, and you beat yourself up thinking, well, okay, then there's something that I still have buried, or a paradigm that I haven't dealt with, or I'm not doing something right with the law of attraction. But maybe really you are. Maybe it was something, you got this because it was a lesson you had to learn to step forward. So I guess the moral of her story was kind of stop beating yourself up when things are coming to you that you thought you didn't want, because maybe you really needed them.
Yeah, actually, that's a good point. And when you were saying that, I was thinking to myself, because we usually say we'll use our temporary defeat as a stepping stone. So what if those stepping stones are actually things that we needed to learn to be able to get to where we need to go? We had to go through them to get to there.
Yeah, it's not always going to be like smooth sailing all the time. Otherwise, we're not learning usually, right?
Yeah.
When I think about that, I actually think about you, Lorraine, and what you said when on one of the meetings that we had, one of these talks, which was basically you felt like you had your back against the wall and therefore that is what propelled you. And that's actually been going through my mind a lot, in that when it comes to having your back against the wall, there's only one way you can go, and that's either forward or you slide down the wall. And you chose to push yourself off the wall. And, you know, that's quite brave. That's very courageous. And a lot of people don't see that. I do think that takes a lot of courage to be able to push yourself off the wall and propel yourself forward to go for something that you haven't gone through before and use that as an experience to propel yourself. And it's like I've been looking at where I am and I'm thinking it's getting to the point where I was thinking about that and thought, you know, I'm getting quite close to having my back against the wall. But we don't have to reach that point to propel ourselves forward. And I think when I used to read Barnes's story, I realized that he didn't really have his back against the wall, but what he'd done was he created a definite purpose and a burning desire, and that is what propelled him forward. He didn't need to put his back against the wall. And I think that's what sometimes, when we keep that in mind, every time we come across something that takes us off track, by reminding ourselves where we want to go, we put ourselves back on track. And even if it's something that redirects us, we can go straight back in.
I think Tony Robbins says, we either move away from pleasure or towards pain. It's one of the two. And that's kind of what, like for me, I'm, you know, moving away from pain or towards pleasure, but it's away from pain. That's my motivator. That's what's making me move. But for other people, it can be like Barnes would have linked massive pleasure to being a partner of Edison's, and that propelled him. It's the same. It is essentially the same thing. But it has to be really, really, really intense, I think, to move. Sometimes if you're just a little bit dissatisfied, where I was a couple of years ago, dissatisfied, this would be nice. You know, that's generally the attitude. This would be nice. Oh, I wish I didn't have to work here, kind of thing. I think when you're in that mode, it's a bit, probably harder, maybe, if you're just a little bit dissatisfied. Don't get me wrong, I get it. I thank you, and I appreciate you saying that it's taken bravery. But I'm moving because I have to move. I'm off. I'm moving. And you know, if it's pain or pleasure, people will just move. I think it's the people that are in the middle that are just a little bit dissatisfied. Do you not think that maybe find it a little bit harder because they haven't quite got a desire? They haven't quite got enough pain. They're not really, do you know?
Yeah.
And that's probably where this whole thing of people, when they're ready for it, it will show up. You know, they're kind of like, God, it would be nice if I had, you know, my own island. But right now, not so fussed. I'm just a little bit dissatisfied with life. Or maybe I'm a lot dissatisfied with life, but not quite enough to even look for another job. Or not quite enough to do anything about the relationships that I've got going on in my life. So some people are just stuck in that phase. And I guess that's what my take on it, when it's like, well, it will show up. And when people are ready, then they will move, I think.
I agree. And it even talks about that a little bit here, where he says that he was constantly intensifying his desire. And he would have to, because if he was satisfied with what he had before and just felt like going and working with Edison, he wouldn't have pushed himself, made that decision within himself to go and do it. So he had to be constantly intensifying his desire to be able to keep taking action.
Mm. Yeah.
That reminds me, Nicole, what we were talking about before when you said, you know, we were talking about visualizing what we're aiming to do kind of thing in life. And you'd said that you'd already visualized it for a while. And I think that's That's what Bones did. Even though he was there, to create that burning desire and to create the obsession to make, basically to move away from mediocrity, you've got to keep visualizing and putting into your mind on a constant basis that which you want to have. So you've always got it in your mind. And even though it's something that I know, it's something that I haven't been doing, because you lapse into reality. Well, you lapse into what we see with our eyes rather than what we want, where we want to get in our mind. And what he did was, I think, something which was, you know, quite, it shows the strength of the man, you know, the strength of the person, that that is where he wants to get to, and he will not allow anything else. It's there, it's having the willpower and the persistence to foresee where you want to be.
Yeah, actually, that's what this introduction comes down to. When I was reading it again today, I realized that what it's all really coming down to is having the willpower to just keep your mind on what you want, and don't allow what you don't want to even enter into your mind. It's that state of mind, having it so strong that you can get through the day without allowing the thoughts of what you don't want in your life to even come into your mind anymore. You're so focused on what you do want, and that's all that you allow. And that's what Barnes did. That's what the girl did. And that's what the guy 3 feet from gold didn't do.
Right.
Yeah, he says it on mine is at the bottom of the page, where he says, Barnes literally thought himself into a partnership with the great Edison. He thought himself into a fortune. He had nothing to start with except the capacity to know what he wanted and the determination to stand by that desire until he realized it. I think that's one of the keys, really, isn't it? It's having the determination, the persistence, the willpower, and a little bit of discipline as well, to be able to hold yourself, you know, in check, to move forward with what you want to achieve. And it's those faculties that we don't have externally, but we have internally.
Well, that talks about those next as well, actually. He had no influence but what he did have was initiative, faith, and the will to win.
Yeah. Yeah, good point.
And I like this line, too, about psychologists have correctly said that when one is truly ready for a thing, it puts in its appearance on line 65. So he just kept intensifying his readiness. And so that he was able to recognize the opportunity. And how did it say somewhere here that opportunity sometimes slips in the back door and comes disguised in the form of misfortune or temporary defeat? So he was ready. He was expecting something to appear, I guess, and it didn't appear in the form that he originally expected it would. But he did recognize the opportunity.
Can I add something on the back of that, Cheryl? Because thank you for that. I'm looking at my notes, and I have a little bit further. Oh, hang on a second. I can't get rid of the notes. Sorry. there's in line 87. It was talking about like you've just mentioned, and I have put notes about, you know, things that I would have considered misfortune, which are actually opportunities, and they're fantastic. And then I read down, and I've got a note on line 157 or 154. So with Are You Darby? Down went the drills, up went the hopes of Darby and Uncle. Then something happened. The vein of gold ore disappeared. They'd come to the end of the rainbow. And I don't know why I've written this. God, it tells you about the state of my mind. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. I felt disappointed. Recently, something happened, and I was literally handed, like, It was just an amazing opportunity, slightly different to what I wanted, but I could have lived with it. It was great. And then it just, like, there was a lot of excitement. It was like, it was so great. And it just disappeared. Like, it didn't, it was just, it turned out to be, it was a smokescreen. I won't, it's not fair for me to just go on about what it was. I can do that outside of this. But I've put here, why was I presented with this opportunity that just transpired to be a smokescreen? I need to meditate on this. Because I don't know if it's the same answer as what we've just said. You know, things are, you know, like, it was literally right there. It was exactly as I described, almost. There was a couple of minor flaws. Not flaws, a couple of minor things different. But I could have lived with them. And then it just wasn't there anymore. And that's happened a couple of times. I will be presented with an opportunity and I'm like, yay, this is perfect. This is exactly what I wanted. And then through no fault of my own, it goes. So it's like a teaser. And don't get me wrong, I'm not down about it, but I am curious. What is that? What is that about, do you think? Like, do we, does that happen to everybody? You get, you know, like, it's not so much the same as getting close to your dream. These are little things that are happening for me along the way. And there's lots and lots of great things going on. You all know that. But then sometimes they just go. It's like it's like tricks. Do you know what I mean? Like, my mind is like, it's not meant to be, clearly. And I don't know what's going on there.
There was something that we were reading this week in one of the studies, I think, talking about when that happened, they weren't asking for enough.
Oh no, I'm asking. Okay, so go bigger, I think.
Maybe.
What, on Tuesday study?
That's just what came to mind when you said that, because I do remember something along those lines. I don't know where it came from this week, but
there's something. Yeah, it's and again, it's an observation. It's an observation. It's nothing to, you know, I haven't fallen, but it's definitely an observation that things are coming, or I'm seeing that it's what's possible, and then it's just going, or I'm getting it. What I'm getting is, yeah, it's different. Okay, I'll think on that, Nicole. Thank you.
It may have been the science of getting rich, that when you experience some kind of failure, that there's actually something bigger waiting.
Yeah. I mean, I see that. There are too many things happening for it not to be on the right path. There's too many things. We know that. But it's like, why can't I hold on to this? It's like I'm grabbing them and things are slipping. Okay. Well, that was my
story about somebody. If he would have taken the one job, he wouldn't have, or if he would have gotten the one job that he thought he wanted, this bigger and better job, he wouldn't have.
Yeah.
I remember. Yeah. Actually,
that's what's happening. There's something bigger and better awaiting you. And if you would have taken advantage of this opportunity, you would have missed out on the bigger opportunity.
The bigger one. It's a great way to think. Thank you. Yeah. So hold the faith, yeah?
Yeah.
And then the power of reason comes in here too, talking about specialized knowledge, which we know is another chapter later on, getting the advice from someone who knows more about a topic than you do before you give up.
Yeah.
That's a line that I've actually highlighted. On that page, there's not a lot of lines that highlighted this too. But he knew enough to seek expert counsel before giving up, and desire can be transmuted into gold. But the one about the expert counsel, I was thinking about this today because I read it at work when I had a few minutes. I thought to myself, you know, that's actually quite important, because we all get to a certain point where we reach a certain limit of our own knowledge. And like you said, Nicole, that's where we need to go and seek that specialized knowledge from someone else so we can continue what we're doing. And I think this is one of those stumbling blocks that a lot of people that don't succeed I think, it will be, because they will reach the point where they need to ask someone and they're not willing to do that. They're not willing to ask, they're not willing to release whatever thought they have. And as a result of it, they end up getting stuck and not moving forward. And that could involve a lot of things. And the one word that keeps popping up in my mind is humility. You know, it's like if I ask somebody else, then I'm not good enough, or I'm showing that I don't know what I should know, or I don't know how to run this business, but I don't want to ask. I think that's where a lot of people fall down. You know, is that when you reach that crossroads where you either ask or you don't, you have to ask if you don't know where you're going. And to me, it's actually a very important point, because you'll get a lot of people that, you know, like as we were talking last week, I went to these lectures in one of them I didn't learn anything, but in the other one, there was one or two little things that I did learn, which had I not gone to them, which I thought I didn't need to, I would not have learned. So again, you know, it's a little bit of specialized knowledge. Sometimes you have to have humility and just turn around and say, you know something, you never know. And I don't know everything. And like my dad always used to say, there's always someone bigger and better. And in this situation, there's always someone that knows more.
Yeah. And that's a great example of going through one of those learning experiences and then being able to use that experience to teach someone else.
Yeah.
And doesn't Bob say that no one ever made any great achievements by themselves, that they always had help?
Yeah, Napoleon says something very similar in the book as well, which is basically, you know, no person has ever achieved anything by themselves. What they're telling us is you can't. I mean, this is something else. It's like you'll get certain people that go through the competitive mind, and there's very few and far in between that have actually succeeded doing that. But the majority of people have always gone with a form of mastermind. I mean, they don't call it that. They'll call it a conference, because they'll sit down in a meeting with their partners, business partners, and, you know, all the people that deal with the separate entities of their business, just like Andrew Carnegie did. Because Andrew Carnegie admitted he didn't know anything about steel and he didn't know anything about running a business, but he knew how to create a harmony between a group of people. And by doing that, by having a group of people, then you always have, you propel yourself further forward, because you're getting more ideas. It's like us talking now. One of us might say something that will trigger something in someone else and say, oh yeah, I never thought about that one, or there's something else. And for me, it happens every time we talk and we're on here, someone will say something and it'll trigger something in my mind. And I look at something a little bit different. So, yeah, no, that is very, very true, Sharon. Very, very true. And here you go. This one's for you, Lauren. Before success comes into any man's life, you should meet much temporary defeat and perhaps some failure. And defeat overtakes it, and the easiest and most logical thing to do is to quit. And that is exactly what the majority of people do.
Where were you? 194?
I'm sorry. I have no idea what line that is. I'm not reading from what you're reading. I'm reading directly from the book.
Yeah, I think that's right, Lorraine. I think that's where he was.
I lost it a bit. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Thank you, though. Yeah. I mean, that little paragraph there is, I mean, we all go through that in one way or another until, you know, you reach the point where you begin to realize, right, that's what it is. And I think that's what this is telling us. You know, just don't quit. They're only temporary failures.
That book, Kathy had sent us, there was a bit in there about failure and defeat, and it said failure is something that happens to you, and defeat is what you do to yourself when you say, I'm done, and quit. So that was really useful for me in understanding between the two, failure and defeat.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I kind of thought, it's the same. I kind of get it now. Failure happens to you, and things, misfortunes, things not appearing as we wanted them to appear, they can all go under that banner heading. And defeat is what you do to yourself when you're out of it. And I don't know about you, do you guys find that you've got, I guess it's your subconscious, but it's like a little man on my shoulder. You know the man on your shoulder that just talks to you constantly? Do you guys have that? Like constantly? When you know, if I'm having a moment where I just think, oh, and then I'll hear the words applied faithfully, really. And the little man on my shoulder is kind of sarcastic as well. I really need to do something about that voice. But it's like, Lorraine. because I'll hear things that, you know, and it's actually, it makes me smile because it's not like a cursing horrible. It'll be like, the voice will be like, do everything towards your goal that you can possibly do each day. Now, that I take that to mean, do what you can possibly do, like literally just do what you can. That doesn't mean you have to work the 23 out of the 24 hours. That doesn't mean you have to be at it until actually you're just beating your head against a brick wall and you just, you know, you're going through the motions but not really actually being productive. You know, when you can be busy doing nothing, I take that to mean actually to do something towards your goal in a productive manner, efficient manner. So when that voice in my head is saying, really, Lorraine, it's because I'm not, is this applied faith? It's because I am sometimes just, you know, I'm going to read this book. I'm going to read the chapter on thought because I'm supposed to read it today. I don't really feel like reading it, but I know I'm supposed to. That's the voice comes up again, like, really, Lorraine? So what I then do is just think, right, I know I'm not going to take it in right now. So I just stop. And then I'll wait until I can do it. You know, sometimes am I the only one that does things for the sake of ticking a box?
You're listening to your intuition, which is good.
Yeah. So I'm the only one then, yeah.
Oh, no. Yeah. Well, I hope not. I hope everyone's hearing their higher voice.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Am I the only one with a sarcastic one?
Well, I think they're a reflection of your personality, so. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, I think I've got some more notes. Something else.
Now he talks in here. I can't remember where it is. Which line? But he talks about the self-inventory that we should do. And so I was wondering if anybody remembers about where that self-inventory is in here.
I think that's in the final chapter.
Yeah,
this is
the last chapter.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can download it online like I did because I didn't realize it was in there.
In the analogy of the girl with the 50 cents, I underlined again this time round that no does not necessarily mean no. And to me, this time it meant that appearances aren't what they necessarily need to be. If you just see in your mind the outcome that you want, that is what will happen because our thoughts control our circumstances. And that's what she did. Very brave girl.
Or more afraid of her mother than she was of the uncle.
I was just going to say that. Yeah. I wonder what would have happened if she'd have gone back with that 50 cents. Like there was definitely you had to have it. She had to have it.
Yeah, it's interesting that you say that, and I have thought that in the past too, but Then when I read it today, he says the word power 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe 10 times. So she was working under a power, and there's no power in fear.
Well, she
had a decision made in her mind that she was not going home without that 50 cents. And because of that, because that's all she could see in her mind, the power was on her side. She did not allow any thoughts of not going home without 50 cents enter into her mind. And that made her more powerful than the other person.
See, if I look on the mother's side, because it's something that I thought about as well, rather than thinking about the fear that the mother would have installed, I was thinking about the child's love for the mother. So her mom said to her, go and get 50 cents because we need it. Then she wouldn't have gone, or whatever she said to her. I thought to myself, you know, it's not, she's gone there with a thought in her mind, I'm not going back without that 50 cents, and that's it. She just made that definite decision. She's not doing anything else. So like Nicole said, you know, I agree with you completely. I don't think it doesn't matter what her mother said. It's the fact that that little girl put that definite idea in her mind. I am not leaving without the 50 cents. And that was it. It didn't matter what it did or what it would have done. I think the onus of it, the nail in the wood for this is when she takes that step forward. That's determination. She said, I will not go back without 50 cents. And when she took that single step forward, that was everything.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what? You hit the nail on the head, Christos. It was love. Love was the power that.
Yeah.
Gave her the dominance over the other person.
That's right, because he had, for him, it was, you know, he's saying, I'm the white man here, I'm the one that's running this place, you're not going to tell me what I've got to do. And so he's got this negativity going on, and as soon as she stepped forward, for her, she's got all this, you know, this positive feeling behind her, this love behind her that just says, this ain't gonna happen. I want that 50 cents. I need to take that 50 cents to my mom. That's it. She had so much love for her mother that anything that he said or did would have made no difference whatsoever. And it was just that positive feeling, that positive energy from that little girl that was so much bigger than anything that that man could have had. I think that is such, it's really wonderful to think that, you know, that actually exists. It for me, it just embodies everything about what it is, and it's just a push forward. Yeah,
awesome.
I do agree. I know it's a thought, but that thought was driven by pain or pleasure. It was whichever one. Something made her have that definiteness of purpose. Something. Because it's in the times that for all of them, everybody, that girl, well, I'm not entirely sure she would have done that and taken her chances like that all of the time. I feel, you know, like it's something. There was something behind that purpose in the first instance. And if it's love, that's great. If it's fear, it's something. But there's always generally something behind that thought in the first instance. That's what makes it so definite. That's what I took away from that. I mean, don't get me wrong, I was jokingly, you know, like her mum's gonna, you know, sort it out. But I think it's either a fear or a love, for sure. But there's definitely something behind it to make you be.
And I
think that's strong in the first place, and literally, this it comes with. Yeah.
The reason I assumed it was fear is because how she said, my mammy says, we need this.
We need it.
Yeah. So that's where I felt a little bit of a fear there, because
it has to happen.
Yeah, that they have to have it. Yeah.
Either way, it gave her, though, it did give her that definiteness of purpose, and she was able to feel that,
good,
overcome any fear. and she was, you know, strong. So, yeah.
I think as we go through the book, The Power, and the next time we come back and read that again, there'll be no doubt in our mind that it was the power that she used was love.
You've got to stop reading my mind.
I think we're missing a big point in this story if we don't realise that it was love.
Yeah, I think you're right,
Nicole. I had 20 seconds of goosebumps when I got that realisation. It was very intense. I believe fully that that's what it is.
Yeah. See, fear can be overcome with fear, and it can be overcome with power, because even though fear pushes you forward, it does have its stopping line, whereas love is immeasurable. And it's like, you know, a mother for a child will do anything for that child, and that is infinite. I mean, whereas if you turn around and, I don't know, I'll be honest, I can't really compare it a lot, but, you know, for me, all I can see in that story, I never ever thought of fear, because the way she says it and that determination, for me, it can only be love. It can't be anything else, because it doesn't make any sense. Fear is measurable, and it can be overcome. Love, when it's within you, then it's something immeasurable, because it's something you've got inside. It's something that you have chosen for yourself from inside out. Fear comes from the outside in. And therefore, because love is from the inside out, it's so much more powerful for that person, within that person, than any other feeling that we can have. But that's just my perception.
Yeah. Also, fear is disempowering. So when he says on line 273, what can you make of it? What strange power did this child use that so completely whipped my uncle? Love is the most powerful energy in the universe, so it would have to be love. It's a force of its own. In actual fact, in line 279, he says, starting at the start of that sentence, the answer is full and complete. It contains details and instructions sufficient to enable anyone to understand and apply the same force which the little child accidentally stumbled upon, the force of love. Powerful. Have I lost everyone?
Yeah, I think everybody's pondering on that.
I think it's a really important point. Ponder away, because when I realised that it was like a wave of understanding, it's really important.
Yeah, because I didn't see that at all. So I'm glad.
That's good. I understand exactly what you're saying about, you know, the power of love, like, you know, intellectually. But there's too many unknowns here. We don't know what was going on with her mum or why she had to have it. Or, do you know what I mean? So I get it. It could be, for me, it could still be either pain or pleasure. But the point is, she had a definiteness of purpose. But it could have been a fear of something that was going to happen to her mum if she didn't take it back, which I suppose is love. I'm going to have to ponder. I'm going to have to. Think about the power.
Yeah. What makes you powerful?
Or instead of the.
Just the fact that he says.
Go ahead, Nicole.
Hi there. Okay, Bill. Hi, Bill.
I was just going to say, whatever it was, whether it was just the love of the mother or what was going to happen if the 50 cents wasn't there, it drove the determination in the little girl.
Exactly.
And the persistence. So, you know, it comes, you know, I know we've spoken about this a lot of times in other sessions, but it comes down to your why a lot of times.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? If you don't have a strong enough why, you're not going to get it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you're talking about a motive.
Well, yeah.
Why do you...
It's, you know, think about it this way. You have a burning desire for something, okay? That is your why, if you will, okay? So you have a burning desire to attain something or to do something, and nothing is going to stop you at that point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How do you usually get a burning desire then? What's the main force behind it?
It could be anything. It could be, you know, the love of a family member. It could be, self-preservation. You know, you go to a doctor, and the doctor says, hey, you know, you weigh, I'm going to just use a number, 300 pounds. If you don't get down to 150, you're going to die. Okay? That alone could just trigger the burning desire to get down to 150.
Yeah.
Yep, fair point.
I agree.
Needs to be pretty intense, doesn't it? So I think that's a good point too. And also the fact how he talked about Barnes when he continually intensified his desire. So we need to be really constantly intensifying the desire, and it needs to be pretty darned intense, doesn't it, to get us to where we want to go with all of the things that we come across, obstacles.
Yeah, in Barnes' case, it could have just started as, gee, wouldn't it be nice to be in business with Edison? And then over some period of time, whatever it was, he kept intensifying that desire. Gee, that really would be great. You know, I'm going to do it. Okay? In other cases, it could be some type of a shock. You know, take my example of going to the doctor and saying, okay, fine, you got to lose half your weight now, or you're going to die, or you have to stop smoking, or you're going to die, or something like that. And that could just trigger it immediately.
Yeah.
So we're talking about the love of life then?
Well, it's
or the fear of dying.
Just a want that you develop into a desire, not necessarily a love of yourself or a family member or something like that. There's various different aspects there.
Yep.
But typically, yep, if you're talking about stop on a dime type thing, or do an immediate 180 degree turn, okay, most of the time those are, I'll say, driven by love of self or family, okay, in some manner, shape, or form. If it's a slow building thing, it could be from anything, not necessarily from family.
Yeah.
And the thing is, it gets us to the point where we choose to, okay, I'm only going to see what I want to happen as the outcome. I'm not going to allow any other thoughts to come into my mind. And that's when the magic starts to happen. When you can just keep your mind focused on what you want and not let any other thoughts enter, that's what they're talking about.
Yeah, and consider, Henry Ford's want of the engine block, okay, for the 8-cylinder engine, and his engineer said it couldn't be done, but I want it, okay? It's not a, it was a burning desire on his part, if you will, but that's not from anything other than, I want this to enhance my business. And I got to the point where I want it, I'm going to have it. So think about, you can't just think about it in one way.
There's different examples. So for Henry Ford, it was a determination, and he knew within himself that if he kept his mind only on what, and he says it as well, if I keep my mind on what I want, off what I don't want, excuse me, I know that it's going to happen. So for him, that's what it was. For the girl, I believe it was love. And for Edison, it was a desire that started as this would be really nice if it happened. And he fed it and fed it and fed it, and step by step it became a burning desire. So there's
In Edison's part, it was born from the love of his mother, okay, from when she was ill.
I didn't mean Edison. I meant Barnes.
Oh, you're thinking Bonds.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
So whatever gets us to that point where we can have such an intense desire to control our thoughts to such a point where we only think of the positive outcomes, that's when we've got it.
Yeah. My son and his friend flew in on Tuesday, and Tuesday night I was talking to a friend who's like another son to me, and I finally got him to the point of yes, you're going to read Think and Grow Rich. I don't want to hear about any excuses. You're going to read it. But because we were talking about some issues that he's having, and and I said to him, on one thing that I'm involved with right now, it's I don't have the burning desire to make that particular thing work. Okay, I'd like it to work, but I don't have that burning desire. When I change my other circumstances, I may develop that burning desire, but I don't have it right now. And I had read to him, like the six steps in one of the later chapters. And he says, yeah, I think I get it. So he's now going to start reading Think and Grow Rich. And we're probably going to set up a small study group, him, myself, and I don't know if there's anyone else involved.
That'll be good. That'll be great for you to watch the change in him.
Yeah, exactly. So, but that's the type of thing too. he recognizes that he has to change something. He doesn't know just what he needs to change or how he's going to change it. But he knows that he needs to change some things.
Yeah, knowing his motives will help him to increase his desire.
Exactly.
Another thing that I became aware of is in a little bit further down, it talks about one of the main weaknesses of mankind is the average man's familiarity with the word impossible and can't. And I did this last week, and the amount of times that I think something, despite the way that I'm trying to think and despite all the work that I do, I do bring up I've become aware of the amount of time I bring up obstacles and I think something can't be done. But not just for me, I make up my mind what other people are not going to be able to do. And I've realized that I do that quite a lot. Is that something that I'm working on? Oh, this isn't going to happen because so-and-so will never do that. Well, who am I to have, you know, like other people that might be involved or who I might need to do something or get out of my way or something. I kind of think I realized that I was stumbling quite a bit unconsciously for a while over what can't be done. And actually, just in the last week, just changing that every time, like just becoming aware each time, because when I read this chapter, that was the first thing I thought, okay, because I keep saying can't, this would be great, but I can't do it that way, so I'm going to try this. And actually removing the word can't, or just becoming aware of the amount of times I think something can't be done, was quite shocking, because I think it a lot. Like, that was quite, like, wow for me. Because my ideas are quite bold and big and things that I want to do. And just even in everyday life, I've been thinking, oh, I can't do that. But then why not? And so just I'm becoming more conscious of how often I say things can't be done, or I can't do something, or somebody else will not do something. That was a really good exercise, has been a good exercise, and it's something that I'll continue to do. I don't know if anybody else has ever tried it, but it's you might be surprised, or I was very surprised how often I think something can't be done.
Yeah.
Especially given the work that I'm doing.
Yeah, one of the things that happened with me, I guess it was about 2 weeks ago, I was thrown a performance problem in my IT work, and I knew I needed to get this thing working faster, and I just couldn't think of how it could get could be accomplished. And in the old days, going back a few years, you know, I would say, no, you can't do it. It's impossible. That thought didn't even enter my mind this time. And all of a sudden, it came to me, you know, a way of making it work. And it was like, almost like an epiphany.
Yeah, it's brilliant.
And, you know, so I had the guy try the modification in the code, and it worked like a charm.
Yeah.
Saved 95% of the time. Mm-hmm.
I love it when that happens.
Yeah.
And what you were talking about, Lorraine, with being conscious of how many times you think that you can't do something, that's pretty much what this chapter is about. And in line 388, it says, success comes to those who become success conscious. And when Napoleon Hill's talking live in the Chicago lectures, he's talking about health consciousness and success consciousness. And he says, someone who is health conscious thinks predominantly about health, and someone who is success conscious thinks predominantly about success. They don't entertain thoughts of failure or I can't do something. And that's what Henry Ford did. They only think of the things they can do. And if they don't see a way through it, they just focus on the end result, and it comes like Bill's epiphany.
Mm-hmm.
Something else I was listening to the other day talks about the tipping scale, and if you can get your thoughts to at least 51% positive, success conscious thinking, you've tipped the scale, and so you'll start attracting those thoughts and people and circumstances.
Yeah, I think that's in The Power, Nicole.
Okay.
Yeah, by Rhonda Byrne.
Yep.
I'm looking forward to that book.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so your dominating thoughts, and I think he even says that here too, when he's talking about becoming magnetized. Does anyone know where that bit is? Oh, here we go. Line
495?
486. Well, yeah, it starts at 486, but he's talking about this really interesting part of the book, Be Master of Your Fate Because You're Captain of Your Soul. Our brains become magnetized with the dominating thoughts which we hold in our minds, by means of which no man is familiar. These magnets attract to us the forces, the people and circumstances of life which harmonize with the nature of our dominating thoughts. So if our dominating thoughts are, I can't do this, and how will I get that to happen, and that's never happened before, so, or I don't have the knowledge, I don't have the skill, I don't have the confidence, then that's what you'll be magnetized with. If you can get your thoughts, your willpower to not allow those thoughts to come into your mind and only focus on the things that you want, you will become magnetized to the things that you want for whatever your dominating thoughts are.
Yeah, one of the examples of that, I was in a Tony Robbins seminar, and you know, he said, you know, look around the room, okay, and then he asked, okay, how many people are wearing red shirts or something like that? And you really couldn't focus, you know, how many people were. You know, it's like, nah, I don't know. And then you look around and then, you know, you're picking out automatically all the people with red shirts. Okay, and it's like, now your mind is in tune with that. So you see now what you're looking for, what is in your mind.
Yeah.
What's that called? Retinal activation or something?
Reticular activating system.
Reticular activation system, right.
And that's part of training your subconscious mind to pick up from your environment the things that you focus on.
Yeah.
And you also get the epiphanies in accordance with what you've been focusing on, like Bill did. And they're either from your subconscious or from a higher source.
Yeah, as Bob says, the answer is, you know, the answer to every question already exists. You just have to find it.
Yes.
So how about this paragraph from line 469? What do you all think about that? I'll read it because I thought it was pretty out there and confronting. He's talking about when Henley wrote the prophetic lines, I'm the master of my fate and the captain of my soul. And it said that he should have informed us that we're the masters of our fate and captains of our soul because we have the power to control our thoughts. And he says he should have told us that the ether in which this little earth floats, in which we move and have our being, is a form of energy moving in an unconceivably high rate of vibration, and that the ether is filled with a form of universal power which adapts itself to the nature of thoughts we hold in our minds and influences us in natural ways to transmute our thoughts into their physical equivalent.
Yeah, I found that really interesting, or kind of a different twist on what I had thought when it said it's filled with a form that adapts itself to the nature of thoughts that we hold in our mind.
Think about the science of getting rich and what Wattles was saying. It's exactly the same thing.
Yeah. I guess it is. It's just, I was thinking, we change the ether, not it adapting. I guess I just went, okay, that's just a little bit different than how I was seeing it.
Is this perpetual transmutation? Is that the one? Things move into vibration. Is that one of the laws? Is that what that's talking about?
Yes. And like I said, it's just stated a little bit differently from how Waddles said it in Science of Getting Rich.
Yeah, it was just a little bit different, but it just caught my attention.
Yeah. You were ready for it.
Yeah.
And isn't it nice that he tells us in a straight, blunt, flat-out way that your mind changes the environment around you. Your thoughts cause the ether to form into what your thoughts are. There was no dancing around the point there. He's telling us straight out.
You know what I like about this is that even though it sounds a little bit different to what Wattles says, it's actually exactly the same thing.
I know.
Because what Wattles actually tells us is that the ether forms itself. The way he explained it was, you create a thought, and that thought becomes like the form in which the ether goes into and forms the physical manifestation of what you were thinking. What it says here is actually exactly the same thing, but get rid of the form, because what he's saying is, you think it, the ether adapts itself into your own thought. So if you're thinking, for example, you know, it's like a jelly mold. What Wattles tells us is that you're thinking of the mold. So you're thinking of the mold, the jelly goes into the mold, and it becomes the opposite of what the mold is. Whereas what Napoleon is telling us here is you don't need the mold, because your thought has already created that form. The ether adapts itself to that form. And personally, I think it's absolutely amazing, because when you suddenly realize that we have the power to do just that, then nothing is impossible. Anything is possible. And it's, you know, Bill, referring to Bob, he says anything that ever was has always been there. And it's one of those things, it's one of those sentences that I wrote down that I like, in the fact that, you know, anything that has ever been created is just a matter of being in the frequency, in the vibration of receiving that thought. So when the Wright brothers created the airplane, they were in the vibration of thinking of the airplane, and eventually they reached a higher vibration and ether formed, adapted itself to their thoughts, and it became a manifestation. Sometimes it sounds a little bit weird, because it sounds a little bit Harry Potterish, and in reality it is a little bit of magic, you know, because that's what it is. It's not woo and it's not amazing, but what it does say is we have the power, and this is the crux of it, to create not only our lives, to be the creators of our lives, but to create the environment that we choose to live in. And that, to me, is massive. And when he says that, and influences us in natural ways to transmute our thoughts into their physical equivalent, when he's talking about the natural ways, he's talking about following the laws of nature, which is something he mentions during the Chicago lectures. Again, you know, these are everything that ever forms, that just follows the laws of nature. And when we abide by those laws, then we're constantly creating and creating and creating. And the first of them is thought.
And also what he's talking about there is, through natural ways, is that it's not going to magically appear. It will happen through people, circumstances, and he says that influences us. So he's talking about the universal power which adapts itself, blah, 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 it goes on, and influences us in natural ways. So the aha moments, or the epiphanies that we get, or the ideas to go and do something, that's one of the ways. The other ways is through people, and the third way is through circumstances. So it doesn't magically appear. You don't think of something and the ether forms itself into it. It adapts itself and creates things and lines things up for that to happen. And that includes inspiring you to take action, inspiring other people to take action, and causing circumstances to be manipulated to make it happen. And the reason why it's so important for us to be taking action is because we need to be in the mode of being able to accept these things as they're happening. And Wallace Wattles says the same thing in the last chapter that we just read. It says, what you want will come to you through the ways of established trade and commerce. So it's not going to come to you through some woo-woo fantasy way. It's going to come through established means that is already there through the inspiration from universal power according to what you've been thinking about and focusing on.
Right, that's a really good way, clear way to put it, Nicole. I really like that. Yeah. And that's why we have to become so aware, because those things are going to show up for us, and if we're not paying attention, we'll miss them.
Exactly. And then they've got to be lined up again. And that's why we take so many detours, because we miss the straight, the direct route.
Yeah.
Sorry, Christoph.
I was going to say, that's where the magnetization comes in a little bit later. You know, when he talks about our brains become magnetized with dominating thoughts which we hold in our minds. And by means with which no man is familiar, these magnets attract to us the forces, the people, the circumstances of life, which harmonize with the nature of our dominating thoughts. And therefore, what we hold in our minds is what we will get. And the paragraph before distinctly states that the power makes no attempt to discriminate between destructive thoughts and constructive thoughts. So what it's telling us is, it doesn't matter what we hold in our minds, that is what we will attract anyway, regardless of what it is, whether we want it or don't want it. Because provided that it's there and the dominating thought is there, then that is what we will get. And it's one of those things where people say, well, you know, that's not what I wanted to happen in my life, but it was the dominating thought that they had in their life. And it reminds me of what James Allen says about an environment is but a looking glass, because that's the thought that we had, and that is what we brought into our lives, and that's what we've created. You know, we've created through having a given idea, and it's like you said, Bill, you know, that RAS study that Tony Robbins uses is absolutely perfect with this, because if your dominating thought is on the red, then that is what you will see. And I remember a video on YouTube where he turns around to the audience and he says some straight afterwards, now tell me everything that you saw that was brown. And not people have to do it again.
Yes.
Yeah. And that is the perfect example for this, because if red is the destructive force and that is what you're looking, that is what you'll see, that's what you will look out for, that's what you will attract. That's the people, the circumstances and the opportunities you will attract. Whereas if what you really want is the brown, then that is, and you maintain that as your dominating thought, then that is what you will attract. That is the people, the circumstances, the opportunities that you'll get. And you'll get what you want. And I think this is where the majority of the population, until they become aware of the power of their mind and how they will magnetize, how they will pull something towards them, is you've got to focus on the thing that you want. So it's got to be something that is constructive. It's something positive for you. And we've got to maintain those thoughts. And that you know, it's, even though most of us actually know this, it's still one of those things where you have to constantly be a guard, be the guard to your mind to be able to ensure that the negative thoughts don't creep in, that the positive thoughts are continually there, so we can attract that which we want.
Yeah, I underlined that as well, Christos, the bit that it says, this power makes no attempt to discriminate. My thought was, that means I have to. So yeah, I that's the only bit that I underlined. Shame it.
And just, I think that's like, really hard for me, is to keep my mind on the positive rather than on the lack. But it's starting to happen for me, so that's encouraging.
Yeah,
that I recognize that I can catch myself, whereas before it would be like hours before I'd realize, hey, what were you doing for the last 2 hours? You know,
that's so cool. That's so cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah, you know what else is really awesome? This is, Chris says you're gonna find this really funny, but. You know, we were talking about when the, you know, when a person is ready, something will appear, and kind of there's that old adage about when the student is ready, the teacher will appear too. We've all heard that, right? Well, yeah. For so many times, Christos, when you've been talking in the past, I would totally get lost. But you know what? I totally am with you all day today.
Well done.
High five, Cheryl.
So yeah, so that's just absolutely encouraging. I go, yes, I'm getting it. I'm ready.
This goes back to what Lorraine was saying earlier about time. Time is one of those things that we have no control over. It's like going and thinking about controlling other people. You can't. Well, no, theoretically you can't, but we're going to say you can't, all right? Yeah. And this is something that it goes into later. But the point is that the main thing that we can control in our lives is our own minds, okay? And eventually we come to the point where we become a guard to the thoughts that go from our conscious mind to our subconscious mind. And when we start becoming a better guard, when we start protecting our subconscious through our conscious thoughts, then we begin to get more aware of what we're actually capable of doing with a single thought. And it's, I'll be honest, it's absolutely amazing. When you look and you consider this, you begin to raise your own level of awareness, which is what you're doing. My latest thing, what I've started to do, is that before I think or say anything, I put a mirror in front of me and I ask myself, would I think that if I was thinking it to myself or saying it to myself? In other words, if I wouldn't do it to me, why would I do it to anybody else? And that's to raise my level of awareness even more. So I become more conscious of any negative thoughts or words that are coming from me, either towards others. Because whatever we say towards others or think about others, we're actually saying and thinking about ourselves. Because the subconscious mind does not differentiate between destructive and constructive. And that goes for what we say and what we think. And it's all a learning process, but it does take time. But well done to you for getting there.
And I have to say, I've been doing the same thing. Not that I put a mirror in front of myself, but I have been catching myself much more often in judgment. Like, why, don't think that way. This person is doing the best that they know how to do. You have no business having any judgment. And I try not to listen to others passing judgment on others as well.
Well done.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's awesome. And you know what else? I just thought of an indication that things are changing for me is that I always had trouble sleeping through the night because I'm worrying about things and stuff. And if I don't have anything to worry about, I make things up. But I have been sleeping through the night for several nights. And I'm thinking, okay, something is working good here. My subconscious is not acting out. Mm. It's acting, it's happy, it's working the way it's supposed to. It's not making things up to make me worry.
Brilliant.
Yeah, so well, that's awesome.
I'm happy for you. Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that. That's cool. That's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
That is, because that's been an issue for a long time, hasn't it?
Yes, it sure has, Nicole. Well, and it drove me to want to help others with it, which I'm still working on. Still have not relaunched, but I will be doing that soon.
There's a sentence on line 513. You'll find it easy, not hard to do. And when I read that, I thought, that's not quite right. But then I read it again and I thought, hang on a minute. If my thoughts control what happens, then if I believe that, that's what will happen.
Exactly. Exactly. And there is a line in here somewhere too where he talks about how people think that they have to work hard. Mm-hmm. But where is that line? And it was in this, but and he was saying, no, that's not right.
Yeah.
Okay, here it is. It is on, starts on line 348. There's an astounding statement, and all the more so when we take into consideration the popular belief that riches come only to those who work hard and long. When you begin to think and grow rich, you will observe that riches begin with a state of mind, with little or no hard work. So there he's telling us it should not be hard work.
No.
Yeah, and a lot of that comes through when your desire is so strong that it drives you and you're inspired to take action, so it doesn't feel like work, it feels like achievement and enjoyment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also it goes back to something I remember hearing years ago, basically work smart, not hard.
Yeah.
When I was listening last week to the Hay House Summit, and I was listening to Hicks, he was talking about everything you should be about being happy. Always leaning towards doing something that makes you happy, and the abundance will just come. You should never feel like you're paddling upstream. You'll always be going downstream.
Yeah, and that's the state of mind when the ideas start to flow, isn't it?
Yeah. I think she said, why wouldn't you be doing what you love?
Because you fall into a trap.
Exactly. You fall into the thing of the competitive mind, right?
Not necessarily.
Maybe not necessarily, but into the state of mind thinking that I have to do this in order to be successful, instead of I have to be happy and then I will be successful.
See, the problem is that too many people, you know, they get out of school and they, you know, they'll take a job, not necessarily something that they want to do, but something that they feel that they need to do in order to get some money. And then they basically get into the rut and they don't see any way out of it. And then you just wind up with complacency. And that's, so there's a lot of people, or they'll go to school thinking that they want to do something. I know my brother went to school, he thought he was going to become an accountant. He wound up being part owner in a shoe store.
Really?
And then buying shoes for Kmart. The thing was, he wasn't happy with accounting. He was happy, basically working for himself.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, and it's also hard to get our mind away from what we've grown up and been programmed to believe, where we go to school, get a job, work 9 to 5 to create an income to raise a family to send them to school so they can get a job and do the same thing. To completely switch our mind over to being, well, actually, we live in a vibrational universe and what I think about comes about.
Yeah, and
that's a really big concept.
Yeah, and the other thing too that I've noticed over the years, I'm using the example of my niece. Everything coming out of my brother-in-law's mouth was, okay, the family has a lot of doctors in it. His father was a doctor. His sister is a doctor. And it was like almost drumming into her that you have to go for pre-med and, go to medical school and become a doctor. And she got into college, and she wasn't doing well. Because deep in her heart, she didn't want to be a doctor. But people will go into these things saying, well, it's expected of me to be this. And then they go through life unhappy.
Yeah. They're giving up all their power, aren't they?
Exactly.
Or you get yourself, some people, like for myself, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I did find a profession that I enjoyed for a long time. But once it changed, and it wasn't fun anymore, and it wasn't fulfilling, and it was too stressful, I'd gotten myself into a lifestyle that I needed that money to support that lifestyle. So I lived in fear of quitting that job and looking for another one, because what if I don't get one? Right?
Yep.
That happens to a lot of people too, where you get yourself into a position where you're afraid to make a change.
Yeah, and a lot of people, they wind up, they get married or something, they get married, and then they find that, I can't afford to go off looking for something that I might like to do at a lower salary, so I'm stuck here.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened to me. And it wasn't all just me that had the fear of having to take a step down in a lifestyle or whatever, if it was going to be, without work for a while or finding a job with a lower salary. Then you've got the spouse saying, no, you can't quit, because, so not only have you got your own fears, you've got your spouse's fears as well.
Yeah, that's exactly. And, so you fall into the double income situation at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And, you've gotten used to having the two incomes. Then what? So, yeah, it's, there's always those type of problems. But, smart people figure out a way of getting around it.
Yeah, and you know what? The universe always kind of comes to your rescue. You don't die if you lose your job, right? Not many people die because they lose their job.
Yeah, getting laid off from one job about 5-6 years ago was about the best thing that could happen to me. In fact, I was thrilled when it happened. Oh, believe me, I can tell stories. But the thing was that I had gotten basically 6 months severance pay, and 5 months into that, I got myself a job that was making more money. I was working 2 miles from my house instead of an hour and a half each way, and then went into working from home, which enabled me to move to Arizona.
Yeah, isn't that the way often where something that looks like it's a failure or it's a defeat, but really it turns into the best thing that could have ever happened?
Exactly.
Yeah, if you're prepared to see it that way, though, isn't it sad that sometimes, like, you know, some people can, even without necessarily having read Think and Grow Rich or anything else like that, some people can just see opportunity in misfortune. Others just can't. Like, you know, losing a job could really break somebody, like, they fear, panic, etc. And if they could just, you know, maybe somebody should teach this stuff. What do you think?
Good idea.
It's an amazing concept.
Oh, dear. It makes such a difference to millions of people.
You know, I can't tell you how many copies of Think and Grow Rich I've given away.
Yeah. You give away books too. Christos does that. Maybe I should get, yeah, I haven't given, I never give books away.
Oh, we lost Christos.
He had to go. Yeah, he's starting work soon. He needs to get some sleep. I think it's probably 2 a.m. where he is.
We've been on for like 2.5 hours this time.
Oh, this has been a great call, though.
Yeah, really, great. I've really enjoyed it.
Really have.
Yep.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Well, shall we finish up?
Okay. And Nicole, on that note, I may not be able to join next week. I'll be traveling back to New Jersey for the weekend.
Okay. So house still keeping you busy? The other one? Selling it?
Yeah. But it's good that way I can, you know, have a place to stay without a hotel.
But yeah, that's a positive.
Yeah, exactly. Looking on the bright side. Well, we'll miss you.
Yeah.
Thank you. I will try to get on, but I can't guarantee.
All right. Thanks, Bill.
All right, Bill.
Thanks, guys.
Bye,
talk
Cheryl.
To you next week.
Nicole.
Bye-bye, Lorraine.
Thank you. Bye,
Cheryl.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Yeah.